Well, good morning, everyone. It's your Sunday sunrise video, so thank you for tuning in. If it's not Sunday when you're watching this and it's not sunrise day, it's okay. It's not really even sunrise yet. So, got a few interesting things to go through today. Another big batch of vinyl I got through. Actually, this last week I was down in Dallas in meetings. So, since I was in meetings, that means I couldn't go buy records and probably saved me some money, so that's okay. But hitting a couple record stores today, we'll see what today we'll find. Hey, I want to tell you a little story about this shirt here. It's the Hard Rock Cafe in Stockholm. Back in the late 90s, took the family on vacation and went to Sweden for a couple weeks. And it took my parents, and one of my sisters and uncle went. And we went to Sweden because that's where all my relatives are. You know, my grandfather immigrated here. He was one of nine children, and he was the only one to come over, which means all the Carlsons live in Sweden. So we went to see, you know, the relatives. Now, I had never met him. My father had, my mom had, but I hadn't. And it was a really, you know, it was an interesting time, especially when you went back and you could see the house where your grandfather, you know, came from. You know, it was out on a farm. It's still there. And, you know, it's a summer cabin now. It was really interesting. But the reason for the shirt is my cousin took me to the Hard Rock Cafe in Stockholm. And so we're in there talking, kind of a nice time. And he kept going up to the DJ and kept going, you know, my Swedish obviously is non-existent. He kept saying, "Abba, what is he doing?" Then finally, they stopped the music, and the guy comes on and goes, "We have a special request. Is there a Steve Carlson?" And so, yeah, I stand up. He goes, "Well, because we've just been told you are the world's biggest ABBA fan, and though we don't usually play ABBA, we're going to do that just for you." And they played Dancing Queen. That was, you know, when you're in a hard rock place and suddenly you're called out and you get Dancing Queen. It was a little bit embarrassing. But that's what my cousin did for me. I mean, isn't that what cousins are for? So there we go. That's my story of the Hard Rock in Stockholm, where I am the Dancing Queen. All right, so let's look at some stuff. Hey, first off, I'm going to show you this. This is what my wife picked up. Now, generally, she just doesn't get me stuff. She just lets me buy things. But she bought me this. This is a, for those of you that are getting my age or older, that dead wax stuff, all them numbers on the dead wax, how the hell do you read them? You know, in fact, I bought new glasses just a few months back because I couldn't read it anymore. I'm pulling off my glasses. It's like one of these. You know, can't see anything. Well, she had this at the place she was working, and it's a magnifier, a lighted magnifier. It makes every scratch look as big as the Grand Canyon. But I will say this, there's no dead wax that I cannot read. So that's kind of a neat thing there. Just lights up, magnifies it, and now I can see anything. So fun gift. There we go. All right, let's look at some records. The first one we're going to go through is Van Morrison, Astro Weeks. You know, most people have it or not, but an awful darn lot of people, especially been buying records for a long time, have this. This came out in 1968, and really it was his first solo album. It's folk, it's blues, it's jazz, it's classical, and it's beautiful. Probably, you know, it's considered a masterpiece, and it's considered a masterpiece for a very good reason. It's relaxing, but it's challenging. It's just an incredible piece of music. For those that are not into Van Morrison, you know, if you just, one of the all-time greatest albums, check any list. Hey, we did a video on those. This ranks up there. Well worth it. Astro Weeks. I've had it in CD for many years. I finally got it there. This came out, I believe, 1965, 66. Booker T and the MGs, Hip Hugger. Look at that. You know, I bought this just because that cover was so cool. You talk about retro, right? 60s. This actually has two huge hits. Hip Hug Her was a giant hit, along with Slim Jenkins Joint. Both of them, great songs. Booker T was the backing band for Stax. And it's kind of neat is how, you know, Steve Cropper, Booker T, Donald Dunn, and Ellen Jackson Jr., they all contribute to a lot of these songs. And for those of you that have watched the Blues Brothers, these guys were all in there except for Booker T. So, fun album. You know, I picked it up for, it wasn't very much, but man, it crackles. So, you know, I saw a nicer version, but I didn't buy it. Wow, look how much they're charging. Now I know why. It was a clean copy. And I'm going to look for a clean copy because I really like that album. That was fun. All right, 1975, Who by Numbers. So, what makes this album interesting is, notice, the dots are not connected. How often do you find one of these where the dots aren't connected? I mean, I could just think back in 75, everyone buying these, bringing it home, putting it on for the first time. What's the first thing you do? Oh, I love connected dots. Let's connect them and see what happens. And thus they did. But not this one. This is a clean copy. You know, Pete Townsend, he's going through a lot of stuff. He was drinking problems, women problems, crisis of getting older. And a lot of the music in this deals with that. You know, he did have the hits on here, Squeeze Box and Slip Kid. But then you have, you know, However Much I Booze, Dreaming from the Waist. There is a lot of other songs that dealt with what was going on in his life. So a little autobiographical on there. For some, they love this album. You know, it's their favorite. For me, it's not my favorite Who's album. It's still good, but you know, it's a nice find. I was really happy to find it and glad to have it in there. All right, we had this one here. Sandinista, and there is The Clash. This is the mega 3-record set of The Clash. This came out, I believe, gosh darn it, let's see, I think 79, nope, 1980, had that one wrong. And look, it comes with a free poster, not in here. But, you know, I had this on tape. I've never had it in CD or on album. I mean, really the reason why is it's not the best of the Clash albums. It's kind of where, let's just do whatever, and there was no focus. This is the album that's like my record buying. There is no focus. It's all over the place. And there's a lot of stuff that really had no reason to be put out. But if they didn't put it on this album, eventually would have came on various compilations. You know that would have happened. So it's The Clash, which was a very important group. And you know, you can weed through this on what the what songs that you do like on here. I'm happy to have it. It took only 40 years for me to get it, so now I got it. This was a neat one. This is an extended play, and it's Dead Kennedys. Okay, so you have two songs on here. You have Bleed For Me, and then you have Life Sentence. You know, problem with extended plays, especially like Dead Kennedys, each side lasts 3 minutes, so you get up the whole time. What was neat is, you know, look at that, they even have the lyric sheets on here. Kind of a neat picture. And the lyric sheets on the other one. So, you know, this is a UK pressing. Don't find a lot of Dead Kennedys out there in the wild, but when I do, I guess I have, you know, most of the stuff, but you know, I don't have the 12 inches, so I'll always pleasure to find that. And you know what, you would think I could get that lyric sheet in there. Obviously it's too early in the morning to do that. All right, here was another, this was a blind buy. Elephant Memory. So, there we go. Elephant Memory. This was 1969. Why did I buy this? Well, there's a bunch of naked people on the front. A bunch of basically naked hippies standing on the front. If that doesn't make you buy something, I don't know what will. You know, that's what a blind buy is all about. Why did you buy it? Oh, there's naked people on the front. So, I did buy this album. Look at that. I don't know which way you want to see that. There we go. Look at that. Okay. Interesting group. You know, it's coming out the time where you had your Blood, Sweat, and Tears. You had Ides of March, Chicago, Zappa. A lot of horn-driven rock bands were coming out. And that's what these guys were. I mean, some of these guys played in big band. Other ones played in rock bands. Anywhere from age from the early 20s into the mid-30s. So these guys came out. They're more avant-garde. They're probably closer to Zappa than they would be to Chicago, definitely so. It's kind of all over the place. There's some very good songs on here. Crossroads of the Stepping Stones is really good. But then you get songs like Yogurt and Hot Dog Man. Yeah, they keep chanting, Hot Dog Man, Hot Dog Man. That was weird. So there's some really odd stuff. There is, what was this, Band of Love. It's like a hippie parade going on. This group became, in the early 70s, backing band for John Lennon and Yoko Ono. And they've spent a couple years touring with them. So that's kind of a fun fact for this group here, Elephant Memory. But, yep, I bought it because a bunch of naked hippies on the front, you know? You have to have a reason for buying something. You just can't go buy stuff. There's got to be a reason. They're naked. All right, David Gilmour, About Face. I've had this in CD. I just decided to get it in album form on here. It's, you know, I like the David Gilmour, his self-titled, better than this one. You know, this came out, I believe, in 84. It might have been 85, 84. My memory's not that bad. So this came out in 1984. You know, I like David Gilmour's guitar playing. I really, really love this one. I thought had a little more synthesizer kind of sounds in there. His self-titled David Gilmour that came out in the 70s really was more guitar driven. But still, nice pickup. Again, had it in CDs. All right, here's a group, Beds. That's the name of the group. That's the name of the album. 1981, Beds. It's a blind buy. Couple bucks. Very hard to find any kind of information on this at all. And it's a one thing that was interesting is the guy that produced this. This one here, this was interesting. The guy that produced this one, Elephant Memory, he produced the Cow Cells and he produced the Partridge Family. He did this in between the Cow Cells and the Partridge Family. Huh? Okay, so I found that fascinating on that. This guy here, well, let me just tell you this. It kind of sucked. There's just not much information on this thing whatsoever. Even tried to find it some on Wikipedia on there. It's 81. It's going into New Wave, but I don't know. It's going onto the shelf of Never Played Hell. That's right. It's that special shelf where you may never play it ever again. And really, I don't know if I'll wish it on anybody. The Beds, couple bucks. What the hey. Okay, neat little find here. Loaded with the Blues. This is the Chicago Blues All-Stars on there. And, you know, you can see Willie Dixon's right there. Big Walter Horton is on here. This was basically, it's an album. It had Willie Dixon, Sonny Lance Slim, Johnny Shines, Big Walter Horton, and Clifton James. And look at that. Willie Dixon's getting a cake. It must have been his birthday. This is from a concert that was in Germany. So Germany was having a blues festival back in 69. And so they flew these guys over because they wanted some Chicago blues. And this is a recording from their concert on there. Just a neat little find. I'd never seen this out there. But a huge Willie Dixon fan. And really, this is a nice powerhouse combo. And they all took different turns writing different songs on here. They even had one that's called German Babies. So look at that. They had a song specifically for them, German Babies. But great find. Really enjoyed it. Got this one just off Amazon. Ordered it, so it's a repress. Doug Sam and his band. And Look how happy they are. This was his first really solo album, you know, and he had like an all-star group on here. I mean, this is all the different people that were on here, and I know you can't read that, but like Dr. John, Bob Dylan was on here. Oh my goodness, it was so many different folks that played on this thing. The only problem is when you have all that, it tends to become disjointed, which it did. It's really a very much more country album, but you know, it still has that Tex-Mex feel. I'm a big Doug Sam fan, but I had never seen this, so I saw it out there. It was really inexpensive on Amazon, so I thought, hey, I want to get this, and I did, and I'm happy I had it. Here's another one. Okay, another Doug Sam, and this is Groove's Paradise. My guess is it's a promotional copy, just a guess. Is that artwork not beautiful? I really wish someone hadn't taped this kind of invoice thing on the front, because this is really neat. All right, this was from 1974. What really made this interesting is Creedence Clearwater, the rhythm section of Stu Cook and Doug Clifford play on this. So that's kind of a neat thing to hear the Creedence rhythm section given a play on here. Again, a little more country oriented, but he's getting a little more Tex-Mex-y on here on some of the songs. I really like this one. It's called Groover's Paradise, and it was kind of, I was groovering. Is that a word, groovering? Well, if it's not, it is now. I was groovering to this thing. So it was a great pickup, a neat promotional copy that found, and fantastic artwork. All right, last week, you know, we talked about the cha-cha-cha. This week, it's about Afro Can-Can. Yes, you can get this. And I was just, this is, again, one of these blind buys. This is from Jack Costanzo. Jack Costanzo. And he was considered in the 50s as the premier bongo player. That's right. This guy could bongo. So, he's sitting around and says, you know what? I would like to play bongos to Cole Porter songs. So sure as heck, that's what he did. So we have an album of Cole Porter songs done with the bongo in the can-can feel. Of course, I think can-can is more French, but this is Afro-Latin. It's a fun album. It's kind of a goofy album. But it's fun music to listen to, something you don't have to sit there and think. You can read, you can wash records to, or whatever. Fun cover, which again is kind of why I bought it, but Jack Costanzo, the premier bongo player. All right, I got it. All right, tuba. Anybody have much tuba music? Can't say I do. But now I do. La Banda de Pueblo. La Banda del Pueblo. All right. So that translates into the band of the people. My Spanish pays off. All right. Look at that. So this is a Latin album. What would you get if you married Dixieland Jazz with a mariachi band? Put them together and they have a baby. This is what you get. La Banda del Pueblo, Volume 1. I don't know if they really ever had a Volume 2 or 3. Maybe they did, but this thing is, it's tuba-driven mariachi with a really New Orleans jazz-type feel to it. Absolutely different, super cheap, didn't pay much to it, but when you see a lady on the front with a tuba and it's in Spanish, well, I mean, you got to try it. Seriously, how could you not just, you know, it didn't cost much of anything, so give it a shot. And it was a fascinating album. It's not going to go to the shelf of perpetual hell of never being played, because I'll probably play this one again. Just something different, something eclectic. You know, I'm in this Vinyl Me club. Actually, I just bowed out of it. Vinyl Me, please. Yes, I haven't really been happy with all the stuff they've been sending, but this was one, Silverton's. This came in a while back. I finally got to listen to it on there, and it was more reggae-oriented. I liked it. I'm not going to show you much about it. Sonny Rollins. the Freedom Suite Plus. 1958, Sonny Rollins came up with the Freedom Suite. This is considered really a classic of one of Sonny Rollins' classics. 1958, he was really taken off, but there was three main sax men at that time. There's Ornette Coleman, John Coltrane, and Sonny Rollins. And so he made the Freedom Suite. Well, this came out in the, I think 72 is when this one was made on here, 1973. And so it has Freedom Suite from 58, but then they also added a second disc, and it was a music made in 1957. Freedom Suite, you know, one side is just Freedom Suite, and the other side has some of the classics on there. It was a three-man outfit. It was a sax, bass, and drums. The other one has a variety of different players on there. We have Sonny Clark on piano. We have Paul Chambers is on there, Ron Hayes. So there's a variety of different songs done in 57. But it does take that classic Freedom Suite and puts it on here. So kind of a neat thing with Sonny Rollins, maybe it's not so neat, but he did, you know, Freedom Suite, did something else. But in 1960, I mean, he was reaching his peak. He left, I mean, he just disappeared. He shut off his phone, cut the cord to the phone, and nobody saw him for a couple years. They say you could hear him practicing on the Williamsburg Bridge in New York. That's where he would be practicing. Late at night, he would just be out there playing his sax. But he didn't play, he didn't do any concerts, he just disappeared. 2 years when he was really at the height of his powers there. So, kind of an interesting thing. All right, next one, we got a Miles Davis. Why that coffee gets cold fast. My Old Flame, all right? This cover's kind of roached, bad shape. The album's okay. So it looks like it would be like, this came out in 1974. Looks like it'd be kind of Miles Davis fusion and all that. But what it is it's just stuff from his era of Charlie Parker. It's on the Upfront label. Some of those had some cool labels, and you know what? I didn't show any of them, so sorry about that. So this one just deals with more of his stuff with Charlie Parker on there. So it's kind of misleading. You see this on there. It was just someone trying to cash in and get some more money on some of the Miles Davis stuff. I like Miles. Was this the best album I've ever seen? No. It wasn't my favorite listen of Miles. No, it was not. But it's still good. Then picked up this at my record store. The Smithsonian Collection of Classic Rock. So this is a six album box set. It really goes through. It starts off here with first song, some Scott Joplin, and you have the Maple Leaf Rag, and the last song is John Coltrane, Alabama. It really goes through the history of rock. The history of jazz. You know, we have Scott Joplin, Jelly Roll Morton. There's Raven Robert Johnson, Hellhound on My Trails on here. King Oliver Creole Jazz Band. Then, you know, it moves up to, you have Louis Armstrong, you have Benny Goodman going on here, Billie Holiday, Count Basie, Duke Ellington, Dizzy Gillespie, Charlie Parker, Cyril Vaughan, Thelonious, Monk, Dexter, Gordon, Miles Davis, the Modern Jazz Quartet. So it's, you know, through those six albums, it really charts through. It has a nice little book that came with it. Lots of reading on here, which really makes it fascinating. Music's about learning. I think I've said that a million times, but it really is. And, you know, you can learn a lot from it. It's on the Smithsonian label. And I found this thing really, really fascinating. Nice listen. I truly did enjoy that. I was thinking here, that thing was on Liberty. Oh, well. Some of these had some neat labels on there, but, you know, as I get going, I kind of blow everything off. I forget about it. All right, so that's what I've been listening to this week. You can see I'm in the CD room. Yes, the official CD room. Don't come in here too much because the stereo's in the album room, but that's okay. So that's my pickups for the week. A lot of big variety on there. Don't forget, if you don't have tuba, something to be out there looking for. You can never have too much. Well, you probably can't have too much tuba. In fact, I'm really sure you can have too much tuba. But that one's a good one. I appreciate you tuning in. Hope you enjoy your week. And as always, thank you so much for subscribing and watching my stuff.